Hello, everyone, and welcome. On today's show, I have a little surprise for all of you out there interested in genealogy, family history, and all the subjects in between. My guest today, Dr. Paul Maier, is a population geneticist with family tree DNA in its parent company, Gene by Gene. Paul, welcome to the show.
Hi, Sandy. Nice to see you. It's kind of drizzly looking Houston day over here.
I know. And I'm here in Tennessee and it's sunny, but it's cold.
Yeah.
So I always like to tell people how we met. And it's one of my favorite memories. So for some of you out there, you may remember I was a past president of Archaeology Now in Houston, Texas, and Family Tree DNA, who you work for, was a regular sponsor. And Paul, you and I met at one of those grand after-lecture dinners that I just love, and I don't really know what your thoughts were when you got drugged to the dinner, but you entertained all of us. And I was lucky enough to be seated next to you and another one of your coworkers, but you had the honor of being seated next to Dr. Salima Ikram. She's an Egyptologist at the American University in Cairo. But that was really a great night. And you really shocked both of us. And I didn't think she could be shocked. I knew I could be shocked, but you really shocked us. And it was just a fascinating evening. And when I thought about people that I was interested in talking to more, you were one of those people. So I'm very excited. And thank you for being on the show today.
I'm glad I could entertain y'all. As you can tell, I'm a very serious person, but it can be shocking sometimes too.
I know some people are out there are probably like, oh my God, she's talking to a geneticist. Like, how exciting is that going to be? Guys, I promise you it's going to be exciting. So currently you do live in Houston, Texas.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I moved here 2 years ago.
But you grew up in
California. I'm a California boy.
That's right. So, what was it like moving from California to Houston? Was there a big adjustment to that?
You know, yes and no. I think a lot of people have stereotypes about different places in the country or the world. It's all the same. You know, cities and rural places, I think, are the biggest distinction. So I love being outside, right, as I'm sure we'll talk about a bit, but no, it's pretty similar to where I grew up. People are all really nice here, and they're really nice in San Diego, where we moved from. And,
right,
you know, the food's maybe a little different, more Mexican food, more mole, but that's about it.
You know, it's interesting. I now, I cannot eat scrambled eggs without salsa on it.
Nice. Yeah.
Which is, that's the way I'll probably always have it. So let's talk about, you are a human geneticist. But your background is not in people. What is it in? And this is what shocked us. It's in frogs.
You know, I was trying to decide what to wear today, and I thought, you know, I want to look nice for Sandy's podcast, but this is really true to form for who I really am. So I figured this was a nice little hybrid getup.
It was. So that is exactly what shocked us all. Like, literally our mouths fell open and I was like so confused. I was like, you studied frogs and not humans, but you work with human data now. So how does that work exactly if you're a human geneticist, but your background is in frogs?
Well, I mean, Sandy, to be honest, it's all the same. The processes, the patterns are all the same. It's really just studying populations of organisms through time and trying to understand where they came from and how they've adapted and where they've moved, migration patterns. So all the tools are there. It's just shifting over and learning some anthropology, a little bit of archaeology.
Right.
Dr. Ikram's talk. And so it's really transferable, I found. And it's kind of funny because most people in one field don't really know much about the other field. Most people in my department where I got my PhD don't really care much about human history or anthropology, but, you know, and then vice versa at genetic genealogy circles, people aren't really that interested necessarily in frogs or snakes or whatever, but it's all the same sorts of histories.
So you work with you basically work with data. Is that correct?
That's fair to say.
Okay. Okay. So what made you, you know, I think I asked you when you were little, like, what did you want to be when you grew up? And you basically told me that what you wanted to be when you grew up, when you were little, is basically what you kind of did. But what made you fall in love with the subject of biology and the frogs? Because there's a specific frog that you kind of like and studied.
Yeah, I didn't end up working on the Yosemite toad until college, but it's kind of funny because the thing that made me fall in love with them and with frogs in general was the mountain range that I did most of my backpacking in growing up, you know, since I was 5 or 6 years old. So, Yeah, I mean, for me, it started when I was a little kid. So I grew up in California, like I said. My mom's a teacher. My dad was a software engineer. But he did a lot of wilderness stuff. He brought me to the Sierra Nevada Mountains, which is this big mountain range in Eastern California. And so, you know, I think age five, we went up to Mount Lassen, which is a big volcano, which is kind of, you know, if you follow the mountain range up north, it's kind of the first volcano that's north of the mountain range. So kind of a valley and then a big volcano. So we went there in April when I was about 5.5 or 6. And it was just covered in snow. I'd never done anything like that. And somehow we made it to the top. My dad sort of, you know, hit the carrot. And we got up to the very top and it was windy and I was kind of scared. But, you know, I did pretty well. And so we decided, okay, we made it. And we'll just go down now since Paul, you know, did his little accomplishment. We'll get to the bottom. So I ended up sliding on my butt all the way about 3,000 feet down on the snow. And
on purpose? Was that on purpose?
Yeah. I just wanted to get down. I didn't like how windy it was. And my dad was telling me all these stories about he was in the mountains and lightning almost struck him. And I was just, you know, scared little kid.
I just want to interrupt. I'm guessing your mom is not with you. I'm just guessing that.
Yeah, she doesn't know half the stories and she didn't want any of those stories. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, that was something I learned early. Don't tell mom the stories.
That's right. That's right. So you slid on your butt all the way down.
All the way 3,000 feet down. And that's how I kind of got into backpacking with my dad. And we did a trip like that every summer until I went to college, basically.
That's really cool. I mean, that's what a great experience for you and for your dad.
Yeah. I mean, I think we both kind of, it was like a feedback loop, you know, I was interested in all I was seeing and he was already interested in nature, but we kind of reinvigorated each other. And the reason I say it's ironic that I studied the toad that's in those mountains is because I didn't know about them until I went to college, like 20 years later, but that ended up being the thing I studied, you know, spent 10 years doing research on, and they were there the whole time. It's just, they're very secretive.
Right.
They're hard to find. They're not doing too well. That's one factor. So yeah, it kind of came back full circle.
So how did you, because you said you didn't know about them until college. How did that happen? How did you learn about these toads? Because it's the Yosemite toad, correct?
The Yosemite toad. And I can probably even, maybe now or later, I could do a screen share and show you what they look like. But yeah, it's the Yosemite toad. I didn't find out about them until I saw a job posting. I think it was maybe a sophomore in college. Needed some money, needed to figure out, you know, a career shift. I think I was a psych major that year. So I just saw a job posting to do some work for the Forest Service, the U.S. Forest Service. And they were basically trying to figure out what cattle, like cows, were doing to their habitat. See, Yosemite toad, they only breed in meadows. And meadows, they're beautiful. Like they're kind of these islands of habitat, you know, wet, you know, kind of mesic habitat with all kinds of cool flowers and, you know, congregate there, but they're only about 1% of the landscape. So they're these kind of islands in space. And that's the only place you find these guys. And so they wanted to figure out what are the cows doing? Cause we've been letting cows, you know, munch on that habitat for the last 100 years. So I helped them basically count toads and put these little things called pit tags, which are like tracker devices. So you can,
on a toad,
you can insert a pit tag into a toad surgically, and then you come back, you know, 2 months later and you see where do they move and, you know, how many are there actually that we didn't find and stuff like that. So, yeah, that's how I sort of learned about them. And it kind of took off from there. It took a long time, but I eventually decided that's what I want to spend my whole career studying.
So you did your undergraduate on toads. You did your master's on toads.
No masters. I just kind of jumped 2 feet.
You jumped from your undergraduate to your PhD.
Sort of. I never got a master's, but I took 4 years off and I did a bunch of jobs in between and just decided that's what I want to do. So
I didn't know you could go from undergraduate to PhD.
That's what they told me too. Yeah. I mean, that's sort of, so I actually was thinking about getting a graduate degree. And I was shopping around different schools. And there was one program I liked at UC Merced that was a PhD. And at the last second, my advisor, he changed jobs. He quit his job and he wasn't going to be there anymore. So I was like, all right, what do I do now? And I had the option of getting a master's somewhere else. And I decided, well, that's probably, you know, a better idea anyway. It's a shorter term commitment. I'll just start there and decide afterwards. And after a year, my advisor, Andy, he's at San Diego State University. He said, do you want to continue? You're doing really well. We think we could get you to finish a PhD program. And I decided at that point that there was enough there in my project right. that it was worth committing, just asking more questions, trying to write more about the species and getting it all out there.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, most people I talked to said, you can't go to a PhD. You have to, there's an order. There's like a.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So all of your research was in the Yosemite area, obviously, for the Yosemite toad. So
so they were discovered in Yosemite. That's like the middle.
Okay.
Yeah, but they extend a little farther north into the National Forest land, and then okay. south into Kings Canyon National Park. And I did a bunch of work in Kings Canyon too.
So what's some of your favorite, do you have a couple of great stories about your research in California? What was some of your favorite parts of that research?
So one of my first years doing field work for my PhD, I think I hiked about 1,000 miles, maybe a little more.
Right.
Because the thing about the species is they're just all over, but they're a lot of their sites that we've discovered over 20 years of a lot of people doing hard work. A lot of those sites are remote. They're like 10, 15 miles away from any road or trail. So you have to hike into the wilderness. And so I spent thousands, you know, probably over 1,000 miles, like I said. And there was one day that I had, you know, I had an itinerary. I'm like, I'm going to get this site done. And it was right. 20 miles away from the valley, like the main part of Yosemite. It was way out there. So I started hiking late, which is pretty characteristic of me. Sort of made a plan, and I was getting out there at noon.
I'm kind of like that too, though. I can totally understand that.
At least we know that about ourselves. So I finally got to this meadow, and it was probably, I don't know, 4 p.m. And like, you know, on the bright side, I got my samples. I was collecting tadpole tails for genetics. But on the downside, it's gonna be dark in about 5 minutes, and I have to get back, and it's 10, 11 miles back. So I started hiking down, and you have to picture this. It's kind of at the top of Nevada Falls. Nevada Falls is like one of the highest waterfalls that goes down into the valley. So okay. it kind of plummets, you know, 3,000 feet down. So I'm hiking along this river that feeds to the top of the waterfall. So it's this very like slow meandering, you know, stream, because it's right before it goes over. And it's like 10 p.m. It's gotten dark. And I'm hiking along this trail that's along the stream. And suddenly I just see these two saucer-sized eyeballs staring at me. And I stop. And right away, I'm like, okay, that's a lion. I can see the outline. I can see the haunches of the cat. You know,
oh, my like God. Up and down.
I'm like, holy crap. That's the scariest thing I've ever seen. And so I just stopped, and it stopped. We both kind of stared at each other. And so for the next like 10 minutes, you know, I would take a step toward it because I had to still get to my car. Right. So I had to take a step forward. It took a step forward. We kind of, you know, did this, you know, in little increments. Until we got past each other. And it was the weirdest thing. It was the most like wild.
What was it? Do you know?
It was a mountain lion.
Oh, it was a mountain lion. I was okay. Like, wow.
And as soon as I got past it, I ran into some people who had just climbed Half Dome, because that's pretty close to Half Dome. And, right. and they were finishing late too. And I was like, you guys will not believe what is a mile behind us right there. And yeah, I'll never forget that. It was just so like, scary, exciting.
Very lucky. I know there was a woman that was killed by a mountain lion probably about 3 or 4 years ago. I want to say in Washington State, she was out jogging. Yeah, that's pretty crazy. Who thought studying frogs could be that dangerous?
I know, right? And there were a couple other times that I almost got hit by lightning. So there, you know, it's wilderness.
It is wilderness. So how does your dad, was he excited when you chose that to study throughout your academic years?
Yeah, I think he was for the most part. I don't think everyone got it at first, you know, it's like, okay, he's going on vacation this summer. He'll start his real job next summer. But I think they were excited because, well, I mean, my dad, amongst all people, understands what it's like up there. Right. So you know, he was happy that I got paid to basically hike around for 3 months. And yeah, I think eventually people understood that this could be a career. And a lot of people go on to do ecology, you know, studying right. the distribution of animals or the diversity yeah. of species. But after a while, there was an opportunity to do a genetics project. And at that point, I'd never done anything genetic. I mean, I'd taken a couple of courses at college, right, but I didn't really know much about it. So I was a little bit scared to transition into something completely new. I was worried genetics would be the dead end.
And this is the job with Family Tree, correct?
No. This is this is how my PhD started. Was there was like an assistantship program for a grad student, a new grad student, to study the Yosemite toad, and basically, you can use genetics to figure out where animals are moving. And since the species is imperiled, they want to figure out, you know, where are the corridors? How does it get from here to here? And
right,
what places should we protect the most? So it was that. And I didn't know anything about that. I would have to learn on the job if I did it.
So how does genetics teach you about the migration patterns?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So basically, you use population genetic tools to figure out where alleles are single copies of different genes. So, you know, we're all diploid. Diploid just means we have two copies of every genetic marker. So we have one from mom, we have one from dad. So an allele is just one of those copies. It could be mom's, it could be dad's, doesn't matter.
Okay.
So in PopGen, in population genetics, we just use these tools that tell us, okay, based on the frequency of alleles at this meadow for this toad population and the frequency over there, what is the rate of movement of those gene copies, of those alleles, through space and through time? And you can actually kind of correlate that with the landscape. So you can get, you know, GIS data. So roads could be barriers to movement, or rivers could, you know, enhance it, or, you know, wet areas and dry areas. So you can use those landscape attributes to figure out, okay, where are the places they have the most movement, and also what attributes are enhancing that or helping that. So that's kind of what we do.
Okay. And so the genetics would change as they mate and the offspring?
Correct. Yeah. So if you have, let's say you have two populations of toads that are sitting peacefully in their two isolated meadows.
Okay.
If you have a pattern where toads from this meadow are moving to this meadow, then you're going to basically pick up on a shift in the frequency of alleles. You're going to see sort of a gradient, if you will, of gene copies from here to here. And it's not just based on, you know, I'm using a simple example of maybe, you know, just one gene or one genetic marker,
They have to reproduce in order for the genetics to change, correct?
Right. Yeah. So it's not just movement. It's also movement and then breeding once you get there. Yeah.
Okay. I didn't want to seem stupid, but I was like, that's a little high. That's a little high. You seem like it's all good for you. But yeah, I just wanted to make sure I understood it correctly. So how did you get into, so that explains, so if we talk about genetics in terms of how you trace how the frogs move, now I understand completely how it was easy for you to translate that into human movement. So how did the Family Tree DNA job come about? Because you were all into frogs and you suddenly go work for a genealogy company.
Well, yeah, I finished my PhD about 2 or 3 years ago now. And I didn't know for sure what I wanted to do at that point, but I knew what I didn't want to do.
Right.
And that would stay in academia. Academia can be great for a lot of reasons. It can be liberating because you can study whatever you want to study, but there's always the black curtain of funding and, you know, impressing your peers enough to keep your job and getting tenure. So I didn't want that. I didn't want that sort of competitive environment. And it's very lonely too. You sort of have to build yourself up and be like very egotistical. And I'm more into teamwork. I like working with people and collaborating. So, and not to say every job in academia is like that, but some are. So anyway, I knew I didn't want that. I've worked for nonprofit organizations. I didn't really see a future there for myself anyway. I've worked for the government. I didn't really see a path forward there. So I started talking to some companies, and Family Tree DNA came up. I talked to their marketing director. And I just really liked the idea of applying everything I learned about frogs and toads to humans, like studying population history of human beings on Earth and trying to help people understand their personal ancestry, where they came from, where their families came from. So I just felt like it was a really cool transition to, you know, use what I've learned almost selfishly, because not too many people care about toads, but use that for other people's benefit. And so that's why.
So when I met you, you'd probably been working, I think, a year with Family Tree.
Yeah.
So, and so you up and moved from California to Houston to go study people and their movements.
Yep. Me and my now fiance, Rachel, who's also a biologist, who also graduated from my same lab.
But what does she study?
She studied water mites. So these little microscopic arachnids that are, you know, eight-legged, you can barely see them, and they're swimming through the water and they're eating, they're predators. So they're eating other little tiny things and they have funny shaped butts. And that was basically her, that was her whole master's thesis, was the shape of their funny butts.
Really? Okay. That may be another podcast. okay. So now let's talk about so your work at Family Tree DNA, and Family Tree DNA is actually owned by Gene by Gene. And it's a fascinating story. If anybody ever is interested in how Family Tree DNA came about, it's a fascinating story. And that's another subject. But so let's talk about, so what is your everyday job like at Family Tree DNA? Like, what do you do? Is every day the same or is every day different?
Well, now I'm going to seem really boring. So,
before we get into that though, you had to learn coding, correct?
Yeah, correct. Yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't really a requirement in my graduate work, but I just gravitated toward it because no one else was interested. Right. And it was just a means to an end. I needed to write different tools and software and no one else had done it before. So I thought, well,
which kind of goes back to kind of a shout out to your dad who worked for a software company.
Yeah.
Okay.
Basically my whole career I owe to my dad. I think there's little seeds in there when I was a kid.
Okay. So what is your day-to-day job like? Mine's not exciting either. So don't feel bad.
Yeah. It's a lot of data crunching, like you said, but it can be quite variable. I mean, it really depends on what people need at that moment. So, you know, it ranges from writing genetic tools, writing software, to giving a lot of presentations. You know, that could be fun.
Right.
Or fixing things. There are always things that need to be fixed or didn't work quite the way people thought. You know, it takes millions of customers for you to realize that there are these edge cases. Sure. And that things don't work the way you thought. So there's a lot of that. There's, you know, we have to write papers sometimes when we build tools. So we just released a big product called My Origins 3, which maybe we'll get to later.
Yes,
and,
hopefully.
You know, yeah. And so we had to kind of write this white paper that describes how it works and how well it works and what populations we used and things like that. So that could be pretty time consuming. So it's kind of a mix of things. Just lots of tool building too. So I work in the research and development department, which is basically a four-person mini team that tries things. You know, we have to experiment and see what works and what doesn't work. And that can be an open-ended, you know, long-term process, just trying things and seeing their success rate and then sometimes abandoning them. So there's a lot of that.
Do you miss being out in the field and researching like that?
I do. But the nice thing about getting a nice job, a stable job, is you can always do that for vacation.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's very true.
My advisor always kind of like, there are kind of two ways that people get into biology, I think. People do it for this reason. They like critters with weird looking faces, or they like to build things or solve puzzles. Mm-hmm. And so if you can enjoy both sides of that, you can always be happy with what you're doing and do the other one for vacation, I think.
Did your fiance, did she study biology? Was that her undergraduate?
Yeah. Oh yeah. She's a big time biologist too.
I ask that because I'm big on girls in STEM. And so that always fascinates me. So maybe I will have her on the show soon.
Totally. Talk, yeah. She's really impressive. She studied moths for her undergrad. And so moths are basically the group that encompasses butterflies. And she'll tell you what she thinks of butterflies. I won't ruin it, but not a fan.
Don't ruin it. Okay. So anyway. That'll be a potential new episode coming out soon. Okay. So what are some of the tools that Family Tree DNA does offer for people to learn about their ancestors?
So there are quite a few. It really depends on what the question is. So, you know, some of your viewers might not totally be familiar with the types of DNA. So maybe I should take a step back.
Yeah, let's do that. But yeah, let's talk about that, because if someone goes and gets a DNA test, there are different tests that you can take. So let's start with that. Let's explain that.
Yeah, so they're kind of, well, let's call it three buckets. So the first bucket we call autosomal. Autosomal just means the 22 pairs of chromosomes that are not sex chromosomes and they're not your mitochondrial DNA. So, you know, every time you make sperm or egg cells, you're passing on, you know, 22 pairs of chromosomes. And then the last pair, the 23rd pair, is X or Y. And then there's also the mitochondrial DNA that's passed on only from mother to son or mother to daughter. So the 22 autosomes, that's your autosomal DNA. And that's kind of, I guess we'll get into that in a second. So let me summarize the other two and then I'll come back to that. So Y is only inherited from father to son. So we call that the patrilineal line.
Right.
And the nice thing about Y, unlike the autosomal DNA, is it doesn't change much. It doesn't recombine is the technical word.
Okay.
So we'll explain that maybe more in a second. But the fact that it doesn't recombine or change much means that you can trace it back deep, deep into time. You can trace it back thousands of years, even back to the first ancestor of all Y chromosomes that are currently on Earth. So that's like about 250,000 years ago.
But only men can take that test.
Only men can take that test. That's right. Mitochondrial DNA is sort of the analog to that, except it's a little bit different. So it's inherited only from the mother, but it can be passed on to sons as well. It's just that sons don't pass it on to anyone.
Right.
So that's kind of the maternal or the matrilineal line. It goes back all the way to what we call mitochondrial Eve. And mitochondrial Eve, by the way, it's not actually the mother of all humans. It's just the mother of all mitochondrial DNA molecules that are on Earth in humans.
Right.
So those are the three buckets.
I've already done my mitochondrial DNA test. I did it like 20 years ago and it's uploaded to Family Tree DNA. So if I wanted to study the male line, I could just get my brother to take I'd have to probably pay him to take it, but take the Y DNA test.
With his arm. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, brothers or dads of females can take it and then they know what their Y DNA is.
So tell me the test results then. So how would his test result, what information would it give him versus what information mine gives me?
If you guys both get an autosomal test, for example.
Okay.
Yeah. So what you're going to find if you take an autosomal test at Family Tree DNA, we call that Family Finder.
Okay.
You're both going to have very similar matches, people that you match in the database. I'm sorry, my dog decided that was a good idea, so he's complaining. So you share on average half of your DNA with your brother.
Right.
But it's not, you know, necessarily any particular segment of DNA that's the same. So you might share a different, you know, set of segments, we call them, than your brother does. And so you're going to match slightly different people because of that. Yeah, so you'll match basically different segments that each of your grandparents contributed to you. And so in that way, you can sort of find different, potentially different ancestors that you share in common, and you can find different cousins. And then as far as, you know, Y DNA, you're going to only test that with him, and you can trace his line all the way back and find patrilineal relatives that way.
Interesting. Cause I probably get a match on my DNA every 2 to 3 weeks. And I don't know what to do with it. And it's so they have to put in, like, they have to know all of their family tree stuff too, in order to kind of figure out the ancestor.
Yeah. Most people sort of start there. They have their tree semi worked out. What you can do is sort of work on the paper trail for a while. And then you up to your great, great grandparents for the most part, where that information is available. And then maybe you have some matches. You're not quite sure where they fit in, but based on where they match with you and where they match with your brother and where they match other people in the database, you can figure out, oh, we share a common ancestor. It's probably my mom's mom's dad's mom.
Okay.
Based on certain tools. And that way you can fill in your tree using genetic information alone. And you couldn't have done that just based on the paper, because the paper wasn't available to give that information.
I just went and joined because I have a line on my mom's side that goes all the way back to Scotland in the 1500s, Clan MacNeil off the Isle of Barra. So there, you guys have a project on there, and I just went and joined that project. So I'm excited to to see what I can find out from that.
It's very cool. And there are so many projects, and that's really unique to our company, is we have the projects. A lot of them, they build over time. So there's one, an Irish project where they're going to test something like 10 people per Irish province in the entire, you know, there's 2,500 provinces, right, I think, in Ireland. And so they're going to add all that information to our Y tree. And then we're going to have, you know, from the O'Briens across Ireland, right, all different surnames across the tree. And then you'll be able to figure out where you fit in better.
There was an interesting, talking about Clan MacNeil from the Isle of Barra. I'm probably pronouncing that right. It's probably Barra. I want to say maybe 4 or 5 years ago, they concluded that they had been, and I don't know the organization that was doing the DNA testing, but they did it on all of, I think, the males in Clan MacNeil that participated in the project. But it had always been said that Clan MacNeil originated from Niall of the Nine in Ireland. And that DNA project concluded that was not true. They actually originated from the Vikings, or they had the majority of them from the Vikings. So that was a big uproar in the genealogy world when that project came out. Are you familiar with that project at all?
A little bit. I know about the Isle of Nine hostages. Story. Yeah.
So I was like, I always realized they were from the Vikings. If you just look at the landscape, you know, that makes that makes more sense than Ireland. But okay, so I digress. I'm sorry about that. So let's talk about the mitochondrial DNA test versus the Y DNA test. Is there advantages to one versus the other one?
Potentially. Okay. So, I mean, one, you just mentioned the Isle of the Nine hostages. We're actually adding a lot of ancient DNA to our Y DNA tree, our Y haplotype. Okay. So potentially right now you could find out, you said, you know, Vikings contribute a lot to people that, you know, we didn't necessarily know about until recently. So you could find out which Vikings in particular were closest to your ancestors. So that's really cool. We can't yet do that for mitochondrial.
So how do you get the ancient DNA in there? Where does that ancient DNA come from?
Mostly academic studies.
Okay.
We get it and we process it and we add it to our tree.
So there's another study that came out, and I actually interviewed, she was one of our guests, Dr. Maria Hernandez from the University of Houston. So she was doing some research, but back in, and that's another podcast, I'll connect it on here because it has to do with Jewish people who were kicked out of Spain and Portugal during the Spanish Inquisition and were forced to flee to Mexico. And then you fast forward to all the DNA tests in present day and all these people in northern Mexico and southern New Mexico and Arizona suddenly found out they had Jewish ancestry and they were shocked. So she was one of my first podcasts that I did because I found that fascinating as well.
Totally fascinating. Yeah, we've seen a lot of patterns like that in our database. Those are called, you know, Conversos or Sephardic Jews.
Yes.
Like
that. Yeah. Yes.
And yeah, there's actually, I don't know how much I could say today, but there's a paper I'm working on with a collaborator who found some really interesting patterns with Sephardic people who moved to the New World. So yeah.
Oh, breaking, maybe a little breaking news there.
A little bit.
Just a little bit of breaking news. Okay. So what's the weirdest thing about human genetics that people might not know or probably don't know, but what's the weirdest thing?
Well, here's one thing. So people ask a lot of questions about why they get a certain result in their ancestry test. And by ancestry test, I mean their population ancestry test. So okay. I have 25%.
Yes.
For example. So the way those things work, if I can boil it down, use a metaphor. So imagine a paint palette and you have a bunch of different colors like red and yellow and green, and, you know, the whole rainbow. Right. And they're all in these distinct little blobs. In order for those tests to work well, it doesn't matter how we design it or, you know, who designed it or whatever. For them to work well, they have to be really distinct color blotches.
Okay.
In genetics terms, that means basically everyone within them is kind of mating only amongst themselves. And there are very few migrants. We talked about the toads going from meadow to meadow.
Right.
No toads are going to the neighboring meadow. They're all staying in their own meadow. But whatever the, you know, analog for that is for humans, they're staying in their own little population. So they're kind of cohesive within, and they're separate from between, you know, different populations. So the reason that you sometimes get this, you know, set of unexpected results is because reality is very different from that, especially in Europe or places where there's been a ton of mixing over
right.
Colombian history, pre or post-Columbian history. There's just a smattering of different migration events, and you don't necessarily know where the boundaries are. So the metaphor here would be a paint palette where someone just smeared everything and it's a big gradient of colors everywhere. And so where do you draw the lines? That's kind of the reason. People get unexpected results. So the weirdest thing that I learned that's related to that is if you look at your tree going back to 1,000 years ago, let's say you're from Europe. So all four of your grandparents are European.
Right.
1,000 years ago, how many ancestors are in your family tree? Well, it's it's more than you even might think. So it's 33-ish generations ago. So that's 2 to the 33rd power. That's about 8.5 billion people
in your
family tree. And how many people were alive in Europe? About 50 million or so. So where are all those extra people in your family tree that weren't even alive? Well, they're duplicates. It's all the same people over and over and over again.
Oh.
So it's a type of inbreeding, but don't worry, because we all have it. It's just a consequence. I don't want to scare anyone. You have it, and I have it. All of us have it just because right. there's a finite number of people on Earth.
Well, exactly. Exactly.
So the reason that you might get these unexpected results is if you look at your ancestors from way back then and my ancestors, it's all the same people.
Yeah.
So the real question is, why don't we have exactly the same genetic result if we have the same ancestors?
And why is that?
So the reason is basically random recombination. So every time, you know, I make sperm cells or a female makes egg cells, we make gametes, they're called. We basically take our mom's DNA and our dad's DNA and we mix them together, right? Because we can't pass on two copies. We only pass on one copy. So evolution decided that we want to pack as much information as possible into one copy, and we mix mom and dad together. On average, it's about half and half. But it's not exactly half and half. Right. So that not exactly part, over many generations from, you know, great-great to great to grandparents and so on, that non 50% becomes 0 or 100 eventually. And so there are so many ancestors who contributed no DNA whatever to you at all.
Right.
And so if you go back, you know, to the Middle Ages, to like 1000 AD, it's only a few thousand people who gave you any DNA, but you had 8.5 billion ancestors back then. So the ones who contributed DNA are much more likely to be close to where you live. So if you're Spanish, yeah, it's possible you have some Swedish DNA in there somewhere from 1,000 years ago, but much, much more likely that it's going to be Spanish DNA just by chance, because you have more shared lines with people in Spain from back then than you have shared lines with people in Scandinavia. So
when you get, I call them the ethnicity test is what I call them, but it's called the population. So really it is the highest concentration of the most common ethnicity.
Yeah. It really is the highest concentration. It's kind of a frequency-based method. So if there are these like data clouds of points that are separated well, then you can easily predict which of those clouds of data points that you belong to. But if it's just a spectrum, if it's a gradient, then it's harder to figure out which one you belong to, because you belong to both.
So here's a question, because I know there are people out there that are scared to do a DNA test. And maybe they want to know, especially with everything that's kind of transpired between superpowers over the past couple of years. How do you guys handle the DNA, and what could somebody do with it? But what are the safety precautions that you guys have in place there?
So the really cool thing about FamilyTree is it's the only company, and this was Bennett Greenspan's promise from when he started the company, back in 2000 or so. He promised he will never sell your data to anyone. So a lot of these other companies might not necessarily promise that. So that's a safety measure that, you know, only your DNA is only used for genealogical purposes, which is really nice. So, I mean, that's the big one. And I think a lot of people prefer to test with us because they feel like their data's safe with us. They can know right. for sure that it's only being used for, you know, for curiosity's sake and not for making money for some corporation. They don't necessarily want to make money on their own data.
Exactly. And yes, and he is just, I enjoyed our dinners and listening to him, and especially how Family Tree DNA got started. And I read that you guys merged with the Australian company, and hopefully that will bring bigger and better things. That did not change your job, obviously. You're still doing what you're doing.
Nope, only made it more interesting and more international. I'm hoping for a trip to Melbourne sometime soon.
Exactly. That would be awesome. Okay, so besides genealogy, besides frogs, besides genetics, do you have any other hobbies out there at all?
Well, in grad school, I got bored for a year and I started flying airplanes.
Like piloting them?
Yeah, I got my pilot's license. Like it's like driving a car, but in the sky, you know?
A little bit more nerve-wracking. When was the last time you flew?
Too long ago, probably.
Okay.
2016, 2017.
Do you have any urge to get back in a plane and fly it?
Yeah, definitely. It's just, okay. It's like the biggest money drain there is. So
yeah, it is.
Money. I think the way to do it. Sorry.
No. I was going to say, like, I know anything about that. I don't.
Well, it's no one for the most part knows anything about it, but I felt afraid of heights more and more. Like, ironically, I love climbing mountains, but I get more and more afraid to do it. So I thought, how can I conquer this in the most extreme way? And I decided flying airplanes, if I'm in control of being 5,000 feet above the ground, then maybe I'll get over it. So,
it's interesting you say that. I do not like flying now. I have flown since I was 5 years old. It was like my first plane ride and didn't have a single problem until I moved to Houston in 2004. And I actually have to drink as soon as I get on a plane because I listen for the engines to stop running and I just can't. I used to get on there and just go to sleep and everything would be fine, and not anymore. It's just.
What changed?
I don't know. I think a psychiatrist would love to work on me and find out, but don't know. But as long as there's not a lot of turbulence, I can kind of calm down. But yeah, I have to drink alcohol, which my mother used to like freak out about when she was alive. She's like, don't tell anybody that.
Would you ever consider taking a flying lesson to try to overcome that?
I don't know. I don't know. I'd have to think about that.
It's not what you think. I mean, most people think it's, you know, like it's risky and people right. don't know what they're doing up there. It actually feels safer than a jetliner because you're in control. It's you at the wheel.
Yeah.
It really is. Like, I know I sound like I'm joking, but I'm not. When you're up there, you feel like you're just driving a car and you're just doing your thing and you control where you are relative to traffic and
right.
you feel better.
So what is something you do now when you're not in the office? What is something you do like on the weekends? Like, what are you going to do today?
Today we're probably going to clean up the house. And
that's no fun.
Bathe the dogs. No, I mean, since COVID started, no one really has any hobbies. Let's all be honest here, but.
Well, that's true. That's
but,
true.
I like to run. I used to run quite a bit. I did marathoning.
Look at you. Didn't know that. You're just a wealth of information.
I don't know. I get bored easily, like I said, so I just try new things. The other weekend I was kind of didn't have much to do, and I've never asked my fiance Rachel about her genealogy, so I decided, what the hell, I'll just
really
yeah I started researching her various lines, and her dad is from Pennsylvania, where the Pennsylvania Deutsch community lives. So I found right. actually back to the 1600s in some cases, some of the people.
Look at you. She didn't know what she was getting, did she?
Yep.
I actually got back into it recently because, after a long time, people start putting more stuff in. And I've gone back pretty far in most of my lines on both my mom and dad's side. I really only claim the Scotland line, really. That's I only want to be Scottish. I don't care about anybody else. But I'm really looking for pictures now. My dad's mom, she died when he was young, so I never knew her. No one has any pictures of her, and she was an only child. So that's kind of been, you know, her line is, I have traced her line farther back. It's just, I don't have any pictures of her. So that's some things that genealogy cannot give you really sometimes. But I'm just kind of hoping that I'll come across somebody who has possibly a picture somewhere of her.
I hope you do. And I know what you mean. It's very meaningful when you finally see that picture, if it does exist. Yeah. That, yeah, you can just sort of see something of yourself in that person.
Well, exactly. And, you know, it's interesting. On my mom's mother's side, her grandmother, if I take all my makeup off and pull my hair back, because they did not look at, you know, they were farmers back in the day. Yeah. I look exactly like her. You know, that to me is really fascinating, because it's my great great grandmother. And you know, I've seen that. And then the other exciting thing was we traced, and I found my sixth great grandmother. She's actually buried in a small churchyard in North Carolina. And I got to go and visit her grave. And that was pretty cool. Cause you study all these people, and, you know, for some people it may be, you know, genealogy to them may be boring, but to me it's figuring out how those traits came about. It's looking and seeing maybe not just physical traits, but like I can trace the Methodist religion back 10 generations through one line and see how my mom was raised Methodist. And so for me, it's combining history. It's combining all these things that are not necessarily genetics, but also the genetic part of it as well. And it's, to me, it's fascinating. It really is.
Yeah. Their history and what they did for a living. And
yeah.
The stories. I found a letter of one of my relatives and I was like, wow, I won't say anything too bad here, but you know, he did some things that weren't so nice. And I was like, oh, I've seen that in my family somewhere. Like, so yeah, you make those
connections. I had a few relatives in North Carolina who were always being kicked out of the church because they would take their jacket off on Sunday. And I was like, there are some rebels out there. But anyway, Paul, thank you so much for doing this. I believe you said this was your first podcast to do.
Yes, it is.
So maybe it will be one of many that you now have a new sideline to do.
Yeah, I like this. It's fun just talking. So
yeah. Any last comments you want to say to people out there?
No, I would just say, you know, Sandy, I think you do an amazing job on this podcast.
And oh, you're so sweet.
Yeah, you're a great interviewer, and I just had fun talking to you. So yeah, maybe we should do it again sometime.
We should, maybe with your fiance. That yeah. I'm gonna bring back up. Okay, thank you so much. You have a great weekend, and I appreciate it.
No problem. Take care.
You can learn more about Family Tree DNA at familytreedna.com. Friends, I hope you enjoyed today's conversation with Dr. Paul Maier. We both so appreciate you tuning in today. And as a reminder, if you're not already subscribed to my podcast, I want to encourage you to do that today. I really don't want you to miss a single upcoming episode. You can subscribe at southerngirlsview.com/podcast. You can also find me on Apple Podcasts and Spotify or wherever you listen to podcasts. And if you're feeling extra warm and fuzzy today, I would be so grateful if you left me a review over on iTunes as well. Those reviews help other people find my podcast, and they're also fun for me to go in and read. You can click the link in the show notes or go to iTunes, find my podcast, then select ratings and reviews and write a review, and let me know what your favorite part of the podcast was today. Until next time, stay safe and have a fantastic rest of the day.